Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Melanie Escher with the Arizona Telemedicine Program and Southwest Telehealth Resource Center, and welcome to today's session, our ATP webinar series here. Of course, with the University of Arizona, we respectfully acknowledge the University of Arizona is on the land and territories of Indigenous peoples. Today, Arizona is home to 22 federally recognized tribes, with Tucson being home to the Autumn and the Yaqui. The Southwest Telehealth Resource Center represents Colorado, Arizona, New Mexico, Nevada, and the Four Corners regions with a combined total of 72 recognized tribes. Committed to diversity and inclusion, the university strives to build sustainable relationships with sovereign Native nations and Indigenous communities through education offerings, partnerships, and community service. All right, as you all joined us today, of course, you'll remember your phone or your computer microphone were muted, and we will be using the Q&A in the chat function. So please, any questions that pop up, go ahead and type them into the chat. We have our post-webinar evaluation. It'll pop up behind, of course, and everybody will remember we do have, I do send out a thank you email with that link as well. And then you'll be able to request your certificates. This is going to be recorded and it'll be on our website later this afternoon. And I'll continue forward here. So these are the continuing medical education for the CMEs. I'm not going to read through this. This is also sent in an email. And for the MDs and DOs, there's a code in that can be found in the evaluation. And if you haven't set up your profile yet with the Cloud CME, I'll have instructions on how to do that as well. And all of our EMS folks, of course, you fill out the evaluation and then send your email back to me and I will get you your certificates. Standard disclaimer. I'm not going to read it, but here you go. And of course, be sure to check our website for upcoming webinars and events. And I know after this webinar, we're going to be meeting and talking about 2025 years. So stay tuned for that in January, early January, when we get that those topics and stuff sent out. And I will let everybody know. Again, here's the evaluation link. I will put that in the chat as well, but it'll pop up after the session in a separate URL behind this Zoom link. And of course, here is our team of experts. You know them as well. This is Dr. Klotz, Dr. Shirazi, and Dr. York. I'm going to go ahead and go to the next slide. And Dr. York, if you'd like to talk a little bit about the lecture series for any of our new folks.
All right. So if you haven't joined us yet, I see a lot of familiar names in the chat. We have been doing this for, gosh, well over a year now at this point. A unique series focusing on diseases, poisonings, envenomations in the Southwest, really focusing here on the Sonoran Desert. So initially, when we started out, the idea was to provide about 14 lectures. I think we've passed that at this point, or we're at about 15 or 16. So if you are new to joining us, do take a look. I'm sure Melanie will talk about this at the end. We've got a whole backlog of these presentations for you. And a lot of our most recent presentations have oriented around suggestions from you all, even some of the stuff we'll talk about today. So if there is something you're interested in, we genuinely do appreciate those suggestions. We are looking to keep this thing going as long as we can. I think it's about one of the most fun series we've ever gotten to do together. So please give us a reason to keep doing these things for y'all. All right, next slide. So again, if you haven't joined us in the past, we have covered a little bit of everything at this point. We've talked a little bit about plant poisonings, and we'll talk even more about that today, but we've already covered Datura, Mescal, Brevetoxins, animal poisonings. Our first one, we talked about the Colorado River toad. We've talked about sea urchin spines. We're finally going to get to talking a little bit about stingray barbs and issues that may come from exposure to those particular injuries. And of course, all manner of bites, little critters, scaly critters, you name it. We've probably covered it at some point, but we've always got more to go. So, animal bites, I think we've just about touched on every single one of these critters that we've got on here. But again, if anything's missing or anything you want to see done in more detail, we are looking at possibly doing some of those categories as well and really getting into the nitty-gritty about a lot of background for these animals and for what you need to worry about being a practitioner.
Okay, so who's up first? Dr. Shirazi or Dr. York?
You go ahead, Dr. Shirazi. You take as much time as you need, and I will bring up the rear with whatever you leave me. But no rush. I'm sitting at around 10 minutes. I can go longer, I can go shorter. I'm on your schedule.
Okay, well, I'll try to go a little bit faster in this. This is a slideshow that had over 120 slides, and I cut it back. And if there are specific areas, we will talk about. Again, I'm Mazda Shirazi. I'm the medical director of the Poison and Drug Information Center here in Tucson. We take care of all of the counties in Arizona, except for Maricopa County. So let me start. We're going to start talking a little bit about plants versus herbs, because we get these questions all the time. As you know, herbs are plant products. They might also have some, what I would say, powders that are not plant. They could be, salts and such added to it. Sometimes we see contaminations with heavy metal. These are usually plant materials that dried out, pulverized, or made into a smaller. And there is, on a usual basis, we see more adulterants, of course, with these. And their identification is kind of hard because you get small plant particulates that somebody now got to put on their microscope and identify. Or to extract the active ingredients and then identify it with some sort of a laboratory assay. Plants are a little bit easier because either we get the parts of them or the whole plant that we can actually identify. And one of the best resources that's available to you is actually our Department of Agriculture has extension offices in almost actually all the counties and almost all the Native American nations. Those extension offices can identify plants. And of course, if you want further help, like how to take care of the plants, what, you're giving them too much water and stuff, you can do it. But in identifying plants, we actually utilize them also. Because not all the plants are known plants, and sometimes we run into new plants. Plants, one of the things with plants is that their toxicity, it's variable. It's variable on what part of the plant is ingested. It's variable where they grew it. And if you get into the horticulture and plant cultivation, you see that there are many ways to increase or decrease specific alkaloids or specific contents, chemical contents of the plant. And most everybody's familiar, for example, what happens with marijuana and how the concentration, even in the plant, compared to 1960s, has been increasing because of that cultivation and genetic pressure under cultivation. I'm not going to be talking about marijuana because probably if you say what is the most common exposure that Poison Center gets, marijuana is the most common. It's thought between 16 to 25% of the adult population of the US at some point have used or use marijuana. So, but I'm not going to talk about that. I'm going to talk about the top 10 or 15 plant exposures that we see in Arizona. So a little bit about the toxins. So there are major groups of toxins, the alkaloids, and we'll go through these pretty fast. And again, these are cyclic chain rings if you are into chemistry of these products. Glycosides, which are sugars or sugar-linked moieties. Terpenoids. Resins that most of us are familiar with, resins of the plants and their uses. They're proteins and peptides. And then there are specific types such as hypoglycin, which has specific effects. Microcystines that we see both presence both in plants and sometimes we see in the seafood that's and food. Such as game that's hunted, especially fowls that are hunted, you can see those, and laterans. There are also phenols and phenol propionates, and some of the most common ones is capsaicin that most people are familiar with and that we see with the hot peppers. They are carboxylic acids in plants. They are alcohols, and we'll touch on those. And then there's sodium channel toxins, and these are there's variety of them. I put these down because one of them, zygosine, is a very common exposure that we see. Anybody knows what this plant is? Any ideas? This is called death camas. That's its common name. Zygodinus elegans is another name. It has zygosine in it. And because it looks like a wild onion, lots of time we see campers and hikers, especially in northern Arizona, extract this out of the ground and they saute it and eat it with their meat, fish, whatever they think. Oh, what a beautiful thing. What happens with this? It gives them a sort of a cholinergic response. They start having nausea, vomiting, get bradycardic, sometimes tachycardic, hypotensive. So it really doesn't cause death, but it makes you feel like you were dead. So this is one of the most common plants that we see, and we see exposures. And again, lots of hikers. I've seen it actually grow in, excuse me, in the wet seasons here in southern Arizona also, and at higher altitudes in southern Arizona. Anybody is familiar with this plant? This is a Texas mountain laurel. And it has a specific toxin called granotoxin. It causes dizziness. It causes weakness. It can cause some dysrhythmias, and actually can cause a what we call the total block on your cardiac system. So you get a complete arterioventricular block, and can cause lots of toxicity and problem. This is the one that we see. This is actually imported, and you see it mainly in at the university, for example. We have it in parks. We see it because it has a beautiful sort of purple flower. But you can identify it from its flower, from its fruit or bean that's hanging there on the right. Most of you should get this one. Anybody knows what this is? This is, of course, poison ivy, and poison ivy comes in a variety of formats, but the biggest two big type are either eastern or western, and we see it in the Arizona. You can see it actually in both lower and higher altitudes. I've been myself exposed going hiking in Mount Lemmon. And we all know that this causes, it has the urushiols, and it causes, that's a resin that causes an allergic reaction. And it actually can sit on your clothing and cause a secondary exposure if it's not decontaminated. And if not appropriately treated, sometimes lasts 3 to 6 weeks. Let me go down. Okay, here. And here it is. With regard to these plants that cause allergic reaction or sort of some sort of a dermatitis that they cause, they're usually they're allergic. They are either photosensitivity, and photosensitivity we see especially lots of our patients. They go either to Mexico or they go to San Diego. They squeeze a lemon juice that has sirolins in it, and it sprays on their skin. These are then activated with the sunlight, and they get a burn on their chest, on their face, or wherever they were partaking, drinking libations that had lime, lemon, or citrus in it. The other ones cause mechanical damage. We see lots of house plants that kids get into, and these usually are oxalate crystals. Kids sort of put them in their mouth and bite on them, and these are hard crystals. They're usually looking as a rod with shapes that are sharp at the end, and it goes into the tissue and causes a mechanical irritation. Then they are both allergic and just what we call irritants by just rubbing. The most common allergic one is, of course, your poison ivy. Anybody recognizes this plant? This is actually some pictures from Sabino Canyon, and these are ragweeds. These are ragweeds, and of course, you're all familiar with in the blooming season and the windy season, ragweed is responsible for allergic rhinitis. Sometimes we say seasonal rhinitis, but it's actually this ragweed bloom going everywhere. We run into it also in the end of the summer when they dry out and they get spread because they're dry and brittle and they get spread by the winds. Here is another plant. Anybody recognizes this plant? Have seen it? It has beautiful sort of a white flower. This is what we call a desert rock nettle. So it has these small, if you look at the end of the leaves, they have these small, almost stingers. And people go to touch the flower, they get exposed and they start having problems with irritation, itching, and such. One of the other alkaloids in these plants that causes problem are belladonna alkaloids. And anybody recognizes this plant? This plant grows all over Arizona. I've had it in my yard. I've had it in areas where I hike around my house. I've had it actually on the campus. I've seen it of all around Tucson, anywhere that you get some water. We have had patients that got this and they thought they got into spinach and they got sick. This is your sacred datura, right? And another name for a similar plant is Jimson weed. The interesting thing is it's one of the earliest chemical warfare agents and the one that was used during the Civil War. And if you read about Jamestown weed, and actually the articles that the locals who put the Jimson weed into the porridge and fed it to the redcoats, they actually well documented the anticholinergic toxicity, especially with the mental status changes, and they documented that. This grows everywhere in Arizona. We see kids chewing on it. Seeds, making teas out of it. I don't know why, but they usually find out about it later in the spring. They use it and they run naked in the desert. They're not only exposed to the plant, they're exposed to the heat. And of course, the cactus thorns are not anything to smile at. So this has atropine in it, a scopolamine in it, a hyoscine in it. Usually these people, again, they get dilated pupils, and I'm not going to get too much into the clinical setting of it, but anticholinergic, what we call blind as a bat, dry, hot as a hair, dry as a bone and such, and very confused and unable to focus. Here's another, these angel trumpet, another one. This, I think the picture was from actually California, from San Diego. Here's another nightshade that has atropine, mainly atropine in it, but it also has some hyoscine. And these are also the medicinal ones that are used, the extracts used to be used and now the synthetics to dilate the eye and do the dilation eye exams. So let me go, I'm going to go through these fast. Solanaceous alkaloids, let's go see. what we have. Anybody recognizes these plants? Okay, these are your common solanaceous plants, and they or Solanum indicum, which includes a family of potatoes and tomatoes, and they have nicotine-like and also similar, some also have atropine-like alkaloids in them. So here I just put down what could be available, and you can see around. And I've seen these actually growing around the valley here also. Here's a potato plant, and especially the non-ripe tomato and potato plants, when kids get into them, they get these syndrome of nausea, vomiting, sometimes depending on how much is ingested, altered mental status. There we go. Anybody recognizes this plant? And this plant is a poison hemlock. It grows, and you see it has that white lacy flower. Some people mistake it with parsley, and they ingest it. It gives you similar, it has conine in it, similar to nicotine, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. We see lots of exposure to this, again, among hikers, that they fancy themselves as knowing plants, and they prepare soups or meals that are sort of flavored with this. This, of course, comes, poison hemlock's fame comes from execution of Socrates. And I know that we had a section on that at one of our gatherings at Desert Museum, that we talked about this plant. Again, it has conine in it. The interesting thing is, this is one example, but birds are immune, themselves are immune to effect of conine, but they can eat this. And if you hunt dove or a bird that has ingested this, the humans can all become the victims of this. So it acts as a vector. So nicotine is another one. Most people don't think Arizona and don't relate Arizona with nicotine, but we have our own. Anybody recognizes this? This is called desert tobacco. Okay. And also known as Nicotinia californica. This has conine in it and nicotine in it. And they can have white or yellowish plants. They grow everywhere. They grow as weeds. This grows actually. Thing the middle pictures are from my own backyard, and I struggled to get rid of them. But we have had both kids and animals who has chewed on this or eaten it and had developed what nicotinic toxicity of nausea, vomiting, tachycardia, and followed with bradycardia and diarrhea and such. So we talked about poison hemlock. I'm just going to go fast, give you a couple of others. I don't think we're going to be able to get through all these, but we get here. We're talking about psychedelic or psychotropic alkaloids also. And these are, again, have amphetamine type or LSD type effect, usually stimulating the receptors of serotonin, and they're accompanied with hallucinations. This actually does grow in part of Arizona. I'm not going to tell you where, but it grows, and anybody knows what this is. This is, of course, peyote, mescaline, and has mescaline in it, and it's hallucinogenic. But most people forget about this plant. Anybody knows this plant? These pictures are actually I think the two middle ones are from Catalina State Park. This is Morning Glory. Now, Morning Glory has a chemical similar to LSD. So if you ingest lots of it or make a tea out of it, it has similar effects. And occasionally we see exposure to these. Some, I guess, weekend botanist who tried to have some fun with this and then they get themselves into trouble. There are pictures again showing that this grows here in Arizona. And usually you see it sort of spreading sometimes on the trees. And in Catalina State Park, it could be hundreds of feet that you will see of these different, usually purplish and then white, sort of a white tone to them. Growing on one side or the other, usually during the wetter seasons. Again, hallucinogenic compounds. I put this on because nutmeg is another one that can cause hallucinogen. This usually we don't see it, but for a while people got into it in prisons in Arizona. The side effect is because it's has lots of other ingredients, it causes more nausea, vomiting than it causes altered personality. Pyrrolidazine alkaloids, these are alkaloids that cause liver failure. And we see this. Anybody recognizes this plant, or especially the yellow flower and the bush with the yellow flowers? This is Gordo Lobo, okay, or the fat wolf, right? Gordo Lobo is one of our also herbs that is used in this area. And we actually have had patients that had a liver transplant that somebody made them a tea of Gordo Lobo and they ended up having a second transplant. So Gordo Lobo has a similar effect as you can think as Tylenol in terms of the toxicity or Pennyroyal tea and such. So I'm just going to go faster through these. And then here you have Gordo Lobo, you have Comfrey, and you have Pennyroyal. We see mainly Gordo Lobo in this area. Cardiac glycoside is another big one. Anybody recognizes this? This is for anybody who's been around medicine. The middle picture here, of course, is foxglove, but we also have lots of oleander. As you know, oleander is sort of a hardy plant and it survives in Arizona. Of course, the worst ones are the yellow oleander, they have the highest contents. Which is not native to this area, but because of its beautiful flowers and being different, some people bring it in. And we see lots of toxicity in animals. Okay, of course, you take a goat and you feed them this, they don't distinguish, they will eat it. And it was about 10 years ago, we had an unfortunate incident at Tucson Zoo where a giraffe was fed oleanders. A technician who was new and did not recognize plant provided oleander and the giraffe died. And this causes toxicity similar to digitalis and all of these. And they're all over the place in Arizona. And we have also had, for some reason on the internet, people who thought that they can cure their diabetes using teas from oleander, and they made concentrated tea and unfortunately led to their death. Another, the cardiac glycosides, we see them also in plants such as, here I'm going to put some pictures on, such as the red squirrel. Red squirrel is another one of those that can cause lily of the valley, oleander. All of these have different variation of cardiac glycoside, and they are also some of the animal, especially toad toxins, that have a similar effect. I'm just going to get to the cyanogenic glycoside and one more section and then I'll stop. These are plants that contain amygdalin, cyanogenic glycoside. For us, we don't see much except, what we call prunaceous plants such as cherries, such as, prunes, anything that has a large pit. On occasion, people either order these on the internet to harm themselves, or they order them for treatment of their cancer, because in the 1950s, there was some time thought that amygdalins and nitriles, which are sort of natural occurring cyanogenic compounds, can cure cancer. And that still persists in non-medical literature. And some people order these and they get themselves into trouble. Let's go to the next one. And then I will stop and maybe we can. This is another other glycosides. The picture on the right top side is a picture of Senna. Of course, Senna is a plant, it's a medication we give. It's a cathartic and it makes people go to the bathroom, have a bowel movement. These grow everywhere. As a matter of fact, I was pulling into my driveway and I looked. There was a Senna plant right outside my driveway. But if you go to Sabino Canyon, you can easily identify these all over. And we talked already about capsaicin. I am going to stop here. These are the top 10 to 12 plants that we see exposures in Arizona that you can actually document. But of course, we're not talking here about mushrooms. Most people think we don't have mushrooms. Having elevations both toward Flagstaff and then these sky islands similar to Mount Lemmon that we have throughout our state also are sources of pretty poisonous mushrooms that most people don't realize. And maybe that would be something else that we can talk about. I will stop my slides now and I will turn it to you, Larry.
All right. I want to make sure that I get through mine in a good enough amount of time. I imagine you all have a lot of questions, so let me make sure that I give you all the time in the world. All right. Let's get this switched over. All right, hopefully this is popping up for you. All right, so by special request, again, this came from one of our loyal viewers recommending this in one of their evaluations. Just a brief overview of stingray injuries. So objectives, we'll talk about the epidemiology of these injuries, which I think we're all familiar in the last 20 years of a more notorious one that made the news, but in truth, these are more common than I'm willing to bet most folks expect out there. We'll talk about how to manage typical symptoms of stingray injuries, and we'll look at, of course, more of my background, secondary infections that you may have to worry about following a stingray injury. So, 1-2 combination with this one. Now, stingrays in the Sonoran Desert, yes. So, looking at a map, we're looking at Sea of Cortez or Gulf of California. And I think the sheer number of these creatures living there is surprising to folks that aren't familiar with the area. So, in this Gulf of California, you're looking at probably 11 different kinds of stingrays that are hanging out somewhere there. And among those, there's maybe 4 or 5 that are particularly prevalent. And in terms of prevalence, we're talking just a nice day out at the beach. You can see some of these things right up there along the coast. In some areas, and we'll mention Seal Beach, if you all are familiar with that place in California, it's gotten the nickname of Ray Bay because the Pacific Round Stingray in particular, there's so many there that oftentimes they're almost walking on a carpet of these things that are sitting there, which predisposes folks to these injuries. So, very commonly seen, But stingrays, as we'll talk about, really, we don't think of them as dangerous creatures. Not a whole lot to worry about. Now, knowing that, we still see about 1,000 to 2,000 reports per year in the US. And you can believe that the majority are coming from, in particular, this Ray Bay, where folks are having very frequent exposures to these animals and triggering a response that leads to these injuries. So we'll talk about a few cases. What is actually leading to these stings happening? Now, we always make fun of these poor folks, but in one case series, 80% of the victims were male, average age of 28. Make of it what you will, but make no mistake, this can happen to anybody. Now, fatalities, thankfully, are very rare with stingray injuries, only about 1 to 2 per year in the US. Now, hard stats for all of these injuries, these fatalities, hard to come by, and a lot of difference in the different resources that are out there. But overall, maybe only around 45 plus fatalities attributed to these animals in particular. Now, at least the upside of this particular sort of injury is that the majority of stings, fairly low morbidity. Now, of course, any of these things can go sideways on you. We'll talk about some of those examples. But by and large, easier to manage than I think a lot of folks may be aware of. Now, I think that comes as no surprise. Lower extremities are the most typical site of injury, followed by, of course, upper extremities, hands, and arms. So let's look at a typical case, quite a few different scenarios that we could use for this. This could be an individual that likes to run along the beach, maybe right in the shallows of the water. This could just be families that are out having a good day at the beach. The weather's warm, the water's nice, and are just wading out into the ocean to take a look around. Surfers may also complain of this or have this issue, but certainly what's happening is minding your own business, and very quickly, things can go south. And we'll talk a little bit about what's happening here. But on the bottom right, you can see a nice, pretty clean stab wound right there. And make no mistake about it, a lot of these incidents are stabs. Stingrays have a particularly nasty little barb on them. You may be fortunate enough in some cases that you're just going to get a laceration, but often you can get a true hit or a puncture from these creatures. Now, how to manage? Stingrays do have a venom. Now, the venom itself, I won't talk a lot about. It is not particularly well studied, interestingly enough. But to briefly talk about stingrays and the anatomy, what you're seeing is we can picture that round stingray from the initial image, and we see a nice tail. Now, if you look at the tail, I think we're just trained, especially if you've been part of these presentations, to think probably right at the end of that thing is a nice little barb or some kind of a claw or something. And in truth, what we're looking at is a barb that's midway up that tail. And when the animal feels threatened, which based actually on some recent studies may take a lot, they're going to start to do something called spining, where they're going to start whipping that tail back and forth. And along with it, that barb is going to go every which way. And it's very easy for individuals to get hit or punctured. And in truth, may get hit multiple times, depending on what's going on with the creature and what led to the incident. Now, the venom, too, how it's actually getting transmitted is a little bit different than what we typically think of for the Sonoran Desert. I think we all tend to think of glands that are causing this to be exuded and then passed into the wound. But in truth, we're looking at secretory cells that are along some of these barbs. So the spines along the barb. So the barb itself is essentially encased in tissue, some mucus. There's other components that are mixed in there. And that's part of what makes studying the actual venom difficult, because you're getting a mixture of mucus from the creature, some of these tissue cells, and also physical pieces of the barb, which can break off during some of these injuries. Now, the venom itself, thankfully, is not particularly stable. It's pretty heat labile. So I really enjoyed this picture. I'm hoping it's not posed. It tickles me a little bit, but at least look at all these folks. They're happy and smiling. Not to say that these can't go sideways, But I think to emphasize just the sheer number of individuals that can get these accidental tags. Thankfully, quick management can really turn these situations into a better outcome for folks. Now, certainly the big thing we're going to worry about right up front, and it is going to be hard to miss, is the pain caused by the venom. It begins pretty quickly, within maybe the first 20 or so minutes, and starts to escalate over the next 48 hours, is when you tend to see that peak, and it may still persist a week or two after that, a little bit of that sensation. It tends to be a pretty rapid acting effect that we're seeing in these folks. Now, I don't talk about it here, but there are freshwater versus our marine stingrays. We're talking about marine stingrays. There is a particularly nasty few stingrays in the freshwater world that are particularly known for having an awful response, a particularly painful response that a lot of folks say feels like, I think someone's lighting my foot on fire. And a direct quote from a Brazilian fisherman that came up in one of the studies: if the victim defecates, he is not a man. If he doesn't, it wasn't a stingray. So, emphasizing the feeling of how some of these injuries can actually go, which we've got to have some kind of humorous anecdote here, but I think certainly encapsulates it is not pleasant. But getting these individuals and getting the wounds into this hot water, not scalding water, can very quickly start to help break down that venom. And often relief is immediate and the feeling starts to improve. And in looking at some of these case reports, you can, of course, manage with NSAIDs, if necessary, opioids. But in almost 9 out of 10 cases, these folks, just by getting their foot in some hot water, are good to go. Now, once you get the water set to where you want it, the venom, and we'll talk a little bit more about it, can, of course, affect the sensation. So just make sure to test it with another appendage that has not been damaged, so that you're not about to stick your foot into some boiling hot water and make this a lot worse for yourself. That has also unfortunately happened for some folks. You may have to allow the individual to soak there for maybe 60 to 90 minutes. So do make sure that someone's checking, making sure that they're keeping the water temperature good to help really get on top of that toxin. Now, depending on the source, of course, these are going to be puncture wounds. Bleeding is probably going to be present to some degree. Depending on how intense the bleeding is, some experts will recommend prioritizing getting the foot in the hot water just for the pain management. But of course, looking and evaluating the injury is key, as you can see some of these barbs break off and fragment in the wounds. Now, here's a quick image you can see of some of these barbs that are sticking out. I think if we're not familiar, and I think a lot of us see stingrays in zoos or aquariums, these are essentially like fingernails to the animal. It's not really painful to cut them off. They do eventually regrow. So I think we're not used to seeing these on a lot of the stingrays that we may have been exposed to up close in some of these places. Now, certainly, looking at the wound, irrigating what you can. Of course, you can probably expect getting to the infectious part of this. Tetanus is something that's of concern. Thankfully, it's not particularly common, but there have been a couple of cases where it has emerged. But this doesn't necessarily have to be from the fragment that's in there. There's lots of other junk, and we're still walking around in potentially questionable water sources here, depending on what's around. Dirt gets into the wound, a lot of factors there that can skew it that way. So, of course, irrigation, evaluation of the wound. Now, we'll talk in a little bit about more severe infections relating to some of the cases I think folks have probably heard about. But certainly, these definitely have a potential to go a different way. And depending on what's happening, any kind of injury to the head, to the neck, to the thorax can potentially be very severe. And this is where we do tend to see the fatalities. It may not necessarily be from the venom itself, but just the sheer mechanics of the injury. These are particularly sharp things. We've seen issues where folks get lungs punctured, hearts punctured, tissues punctured. That is really the major concern, where this is going to require hospitalization, and not removing whatever fragments you might see on site. That would be one major thing I would differentiate for those more severe wounds, is not removing them if it looks like it's head, neck, or somewhere in the chest. Leave those in and let's get to the hospital for an evaluation. Now, again, the sources are a little bit all over here. A lot of places will say, oh, yeah, the barbed fragments, they're radio opaque. You're going to pick them up on a plain film. But the reality is, these stingrays relate a lot to sharks in that they're mostly cartilaginous. These do not always show up on plain films, and oftentimes you may need some other imaging modalities to really get at this, or in some cases, just an exploration of what's going on at the wound. And like I mentioned, these can fragment into a lot of different little chunks that may need to be taken out. Now, in one case series, trying to get an idea of do we always need to do imaging? And I will be interested in your take on this too, Dr. Shirazi, for your expert take. Not really a strong recommendation in the literature, not really a recommendation at all, honestly. It's not commented on. Imaging was obtained in about 57% of patients in one case series, about 119, 120 patients. Only in two of those cases were foreign bodies found. Now, was it that there weren't foreign bodies? Not necessarily. Maybe they just weren't seen on imaging. And it's worth noting that of these two, only one of them was a definite barb. One of them actually ended up looking like it's probably just sand and some junk that got in there. Now, surgery debridement may absolutely be necessary in some cases. So, tissue necrosis is something that we're going to worry a bit more about. The venom, we'll talk a little bit more about some of the systemic effects. Tissue necrosis, thankfully or unthankfully, we're going to see more of these in the marine stingrays. Freshwater stingrays, the only thing I'll say about it, they're typically a higher risk of tissue necrosis just by nature of the sheer number of these secretory cells that are there at the barbs, the surface area. But tissue necrosis is something we're going to worry about, especially for folks that may have these penetrating injuries where something is left. Now, take a look at this poor fellow. You can see the size of this barb that they took out of the foot right there near the top. And these are not necessarily small things, and they are particularly sharp. I mean, it is essentially a serrated knife. And again, why it may be best to wait for surgery to evaluate this is it's like driving backwards over trying to keep cars from leaving parking lots the wrong way. Pulling them out, they're serrated. You're probably going to do more damage yanking them out than you did putting them in there in the first place. So removing with care, especially again, head, neck, chest, critical. This poor individual, you can see some edema, which is not uncommon with exposures to these types of injuries. The barb was removed, but even still, a week or so later, the wound continued to darken, and eventually surgical debridement was needed. Thankfully, this guy, full recovery is as nasty and as deep as that wound actually looks, with just some increased sensitivity at the site. Now, the venom, again, hard to characterize, not particularly well studied. It is a bit different depending on what exactly we're talking about, the maturity of the animal. But looking at the venom, it tends to have some pretty typical things that have come up in discussing other toxins, even in our discussion of the Sonoran Desert. Phosphodiesterase, 5-nucleotidase, cell destructive components that we're seeing in there, serotonin, causing some of that smooth muscle contraction or issues there, and essentially leading to a particularly painful injury for these individuals. Now, how to avoid this, I think a lot of folks have heard of, is just shuffling your feet, making sure that when you are going out to these areas, if you're worried about it, just shuffling your feet along. Again, these animals typically are not aggressive. They, in a lot of cases, aren't even particularly defensive. They just want to get away from you. And shuffling your feet can startle them, cause them to move away. Visually looking for these animals may not be the most reliable thing, as if you look at this picture, you can see an unburied stingray and one that's buried. If you really look, you can see the outline, but very easy to miss. And again, depending on where you are and the time of year, the weather that day, there could be tons of these things lying out there waiting for you. So, when to send these folks to the hospital? Certainly ongoing bleeding. Again, just to reemphasize, head, neck, chest, absolutely would send. There's some recent cases looking at particularly nasty stingray injuries where just a hair away from lungs, if folks maybe were swimming along pretty near the coast there. A lot of things that can happen, a lot of things to worry about with those kinds of injuries. Now, systemic toxicity is going to be something to worry about with these particular injuries. Of course, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. We do see some hemorrhagic effects from a lot of the venoms in these creatures. Certainly, seizures, arrhythmias are, of course, possible. We've got some serotonergic responses that are going to be going on there. And pain that's failing to significantly improve, though thankfully, fast management typically does get a handle on that. All right, now more severe injuries, as we've mentioned. Fatalities are traditionally coming from the wounds and not necessarily the venom. Clearly, the venom is not helping anything, and if there's puncture wounds and something stuck in there, this is probably going to get a lot worse. But just the sheer mechanical injury that can be caused by some of these exposures, again, remember, this is a almost wild, frenzied attack from a creature that is not really sure what's going on. That tail's whipping back and forth. There can be multiple hits that you get from some of these creatures. In looking at it, even just grazing some of these stingrays doesn't always seem like it's enough to really startle them to attack. It may be only 5% of those exposures do folks actually get a hit. The worst seem to come from accidentally stepping right on the stingray and pinning it down. That's where you tend to see a lot more of these hits, these punctures actually taking place. Now, again, for the more severe injuries, things you can do, basic wound management, seeing what you can do there while trying to avoid removing deeply penetrating injuries. Getting an EKG cardiac workup is not at all a bad idea, especially for someone getting an injury to the chest. Now, secondary infections, literature is a bit more sparse on what to worry about here, and this can follow several days after the initial exposure. Tetanus has been reported, so our usual wound prophylaxis recommendations apply here for doing tetanus vaccines. There is a lot of debate about whether or not to just empirically administer antibiotics. A lot of the data is probably skewing towards no. It's probably not always necessary to do this, particularly for these relatively superficial injuries that aren't particularly deep if fast management with pain relief is present. But there have certainly been cases where some unusual fellows have showed up following that initial management of the wound. Of course, in looking at these water exposures, Vibrio is something to consider. This may warrant then usually a third generation cephalosporin plus usually either a tetracycline or a fluoroquinolone. Staphylococcus, streptococcus, not at all unusual here. Some bizarre cases of Mycobacterium marinum, again, more probably from the water exposure than anything. And a couple of odd cases of fungal infections with Fusarium salani, which my understanding of more stingray infectious processes is a pathogen that they tend to have to worry a bit more about. If they're potentially dealing with that infection, they may pass it on to you. I can't say I strongly recommend fungal prophylaxis for these folks. In looking at what has typically been done for antibiotic prophylaxis, typically, what I'm seeing done the most is usually just monotherapy, and it's usually Cipro or Levo. There are certainly cases where Augmentin has been done, maybe a tetracycline, and oftentimes that's usually good enough. So, in conclusion, typical exposures here in the US can quickly and easily be managed. If you decide to take a swim in the Amazon someday, quick management may help the pain. It may not help tissue necrosis because those are a nastier bit of stingrays to worry about. Emphasis on keeping the wound cleaned, managing the pain. I wouldn't recommend removing these barbs in the field for these head, neck, chest wounds. Again, the penetrating injury is probably far more severe, and pulling it out is going to only increase the damage done and potentially make a bad situation a lot worse. And general avoidance for anyone here, if you're joining us for general interest, shuffling your feet along while wading through the ocean. Some folks will throw dirt on top of the critters if they're close enough. Typically, stuff getting on top of the stingrays will also cause them to want to get away from you. But shuffling the feet, certainly the easiest thing that can be done. So I know we've got a little bit of time for questions, but I have a question for Dr. Shirazi. How often are you seeing folks calling in with either more severe symptoms from the envenomation or with these penetrating injuries from your experience? That data was hard to parse.
So, our colleagues in San Diego actually see the most, and colleague Dr. Clark actually has written the most extensive exposures. If you go at the peak of season, you will see that almost every lifeguard has a couple of buckets behind them, and sometimes people are sitting there, sometimes not. But that's one thing that their poison center actually implemented, and they have heating units so that they can get the water to about 38 degrees centigrade, 38.5, which is 101.4, 101, 102. And that's what they do. We do see some coming from Mexico, but usually by the time they get here, they have resolved, the pain has resolved. I saw that one of our actually pan, not one of our participants had experienced the same thing. And I
Yes.
actually took care of my daughter in San Carlos, Mexico. She went into the water and she got injuries similar to what you show on the first picture, right above her ankle. Usually it's recommended, and I talked to our colleagues in Australia, they see actually more than we see in the US. And their recommendation is to wash it, giving prophylaxis for tetanus, and they don't close the wound. If the wound is big, they take an X-ray. There are lots of times that, as you said, the X-ray doesn't show anything because this is like taking a picture of your nail. And the other thing is, even if you find something, it's hard. Digging it out causes more problems. Sometimes they just leave the wound open and it will come out. There is also periosteum reaction that can be pretty painful. So when the venom effect is actually is minimized or destroyed by heat, some have persisting problems, and they are also recommended to take X-ray. And you can have actually months of swelling. And if it persists for more than 2 weeks, there is a recommendation for X-ray to look for foreign body or damage to the bone. Sometimes they just sit in the periosteum, and it's that periosteal reaction that they have. So yes, we do see it, but by the time they usually come back to Arizona, they have resolve. In Mexico, I don't know if you have realized, these stingrays don't have much of a fishing value. So we see that they're fished out at really not very deep areas. And in the desert, you can actually see sometimes thousands of them. They're just dumped from the fishing boats. They're just dumped there. And they are seeing some changes in the species that are coming now further up, displacing what has been fished out. And one of our colleagues in Mexico was telling us that they're seeing many more syncopal episodes with initial envenomation, which we usually don't see.
Wow.
And they were wondering whether this is because of the change of some of the species that are now displacing what was fished out.
That's what I was seeing for a lot of these places in California is the numbers of these stingrays are increasing and the numbers are just going up. And I think it is this displacement.
Yeah, and but yeah, we do see it, and but by the time they get to here, it's usually we see both jellyfish stings, we see stingray, and I actually talked to the gentleman who was on the boat with Steve Irving, who was not envenomated but had a traumatic injury, and one of the ways that rays defend themselves against the sharks is actually the spiking. and they repel the shark. And Steve Irwin sort of approached the ray in a similar fashion, and it penetrated his chest, and he had actually had a penetrating trauma to his heart. And the way that this colleague was describing it, with every when they fished him out of the ocean, they were so far out that they couldn't get the helicopter in, and with every movement of his heart, the ray's stinger was getting more and more pulled into, because of the shape of the teats that's on it, which is almost hooks. It got pulled into his heart, and it caused not only anterior but the posterior ventricular damage. It got pulled in and poked a hole in the back, and he just bled to death in the middle of the ocean.
There are a lot of questions on the chat if you want to look, Larry.
That was our last big one. I don't think we've got any other questions here. If you do have questions, going once, going twice. But that was our one big one that we did get, unless I'm missing something here.
We had a bunch of comments, and
Yeah,
then
I got
there, yeah.
a lot of folks interested in this one. The weird topics are always the best topics.
Hey, and this was one of the topics that came from the evaluation. So please go ahead and do that evaluation when we're finished here, and let us know what else you'd like to learn about, in this series. So this was our last one for 2024, and we are looking forward to coming up with the schedule and different topics for 2025. And with that, it's 102, and we're done. So again, thank you everybody for joining us. Please do the evaluation, and this will be put up onto our website so you can review it later along with the handouts. Dr. Shirazi's file is pretty big, so he's gonna adjust it for us and get it sent. We'll get that uploaded, and we already have Larry the pharmacist's slides. So anyways, thank you again everybody for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you in 2025. Have a great rest of your year. Thank you, everyone.